The next question was, if you see similar trends in adults, and this is an adult, where you actually see a dose-dependent increase in risk with each risk factor that you had. So this is risk particularly stroke or myocardial infarction. So this black line, the top line, is another incidence of individuals who received, who have multiple cardiovascular risk factors. And what you see is that there's a strong effect and highest risk with individuals who have multiple cardiovascular risk factors who also have been treated with the cardiotoxic therapy. So there's almost a synergistic effect in terms of what the risk, the increased risk that you're seeing in this group. So let's interrogate this a little bit more. Is it all risk factors? Do certain risk factors drive it more than others? And what we see quite clearly is that really what's driving the risk the most, and this is the risk of developing a major cardiovascular event, is a lot of this is driven by hypertension and diabetes. And this is especially important for our pediatric population because we can think about novel interventions. And in this case, going back to that chronic remodeling process that we talked about, where does hypertension really play into this accelerated remodeling? Well, it's essentially just adding to the increase in the total cardiovascular resistance that you're seeing at baseline. So potentially, aggressively managing someone's high blood pressure could really slow down, in some cases, reverse this process of chronic remodeling and hopefully avert the risk of cardiovascular disease. What about exercise? What is the role of exercise play? We can have a whole hour talk on exercise, but there have now been a number of studies that have actually shown that as you increase the intensity of exercise, you increase your risk of any cardiovascular disease risk in the cancer survivor population, as well as coronary artery disease. And in fact, based on this threshold that they used, there was a reduction in risk by 50%. So simple lifestyle behavior modification in our child cancer survivor population, as well as the adult cancer survivor population, could lead to substantial improvements in outcomes. So where are we at? So we know that when we're talking about patient care, that there are certain cancer-related treatments that are associated with their own toxicity, that there are a number of cardiovascular health and risk factors that sort of interplay and have a role in modifying risk, and there are also unique hosts and variables, such as genomic risk, et cetera, that may modify this risk. How do we look at this problem? Well, I think we need to continue our ongoing efforts, sort of our epidemiologic work and registry research, to identify what is the changing landscape with changing treatments and paradigms over time. In terms of oncology care, do we see different patterns of shifting? What is the current state of oncology clinical trials and how we understand cardiovascular risk detection and in this particular group? How do we image them? How do we monitor them during therapy? And how do we develop the next generation of studies looking at simple, basic translational studies and clinical research to help us understand the pathophysiology and mechanisms that drive this risk? And in some cases, we believe that there's an accelerated risk. What's driving this accelerated risk? We need a continued effort in sort of understanding this pre-symptomatic state so that we can develop the prevention and lifestyle intervention that we have done for the pediatric population, and in turn set the stage for guidelines and clinical practice standards, and then disseminate this to the general oncology and cardiology community so that clearly this is not something that, you know, we're talking about in silos, but something that we're talking across disciplines. And I'm especially honored to be here talking to you at such an illustrious institution, because I think the more we have these dialogues, the more we have the opportunity to come up with some innovative approaches to help mitigate the risk. So I want to end here by acknowledging folks at City of Hope, who are in my group, and then collaborators here at Penn Medical Institute, who have been really instrumental for a lot of this, as well as the funding agencies. And thank you for your time and your attention. I'm happy to take any questions in now.
Not the least, and then the other end of it, you have images, right? And I'm not as convinced that
the imaging parameters are solid enough, at least in the pediatric population, that you can implement them across 200 plus institutions. You may be able to do them across selected institutions. But as strain and other sort of early markers start emerging and being prognostic, maybe there'll be increased acceptance in this group. That's a very real challenge. And then the big question is, what do you do about it, right? So you find these markers. So if someone really going to pull the trigger on some intervention, like, and then during treatment, you know, put them on the big walkers, put them on whatever it is that you need to put them on. The final thing I'll say is that the more we study this, the more we understand how nuanced some of these things are and some of the inter-individual variation in the germline. So one of the simple things we could do is if we could continue to validate some of these genetic association studies, we can actually think about upfront changes to therapy, right? Think about sort of upfront avoidance of certain drugs if you have a comparable regimen that's going to be the same kind of outcome for certain other populations. So this entire population is precision. But, you know, we do that to some extent in our pediatric world because we do tailored interventions based on certain molecular profiling, et cetera. But why can't we integrate that with the acute toxicity data as well as the long-term toxicity data upfront in our decision making? And in the pediatric oncology world, we're very lucky. We have, you know, overall survival in some cases reaching 90-95%. We're never going to design a clinical trial that's going to improve our survival rates above 95%. You're never going to do that. So then you can start thinking about clinical trials that use novel approaches for risk reduction, and whether it's acute toxicity or long-term, based on some of these risk factors. So, we have a long answer. I get passionate about it. Well, thank you for your time. Appreciate it.
I am delighted to introduce Dr. Zubin Deepin, who is an associate professor of medicine at the DCRI. He received his medical degree from Duke University in 2005 and completed his internal medicine residency and fellowship in cardiology here at Duke. He's the director of the Duke Heart Failure Same Day Access Clinic and director of education IT innovations in the Department of Medicine. Research conference today is a little bit like buying candy the day after Halloween. It's buy one, get one free. We also have Dr. Eric Eisenstein, who will be speaking to us today. He is an associate professor in medicine and associate professor in community and family medicine here at Duke. He received his DBA from Cleveland State University in 1995 and has served as a PI for several phase 2, 3, and 4 economic and quality health of life studies in a range of therapeutic areas, including cardiovascular, emergency medicine, and pulmonary disease. And his primary research interests are in evaluating information technologies as interventions in healthcare systems. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Eisenstein first and then Dr. Eisenstein.
All right, well, good afternoon, everybody. Can you hear me okay? So it's a pleasure to be here. We actually have a very, I guess, mixed platter of topics today. The whole idea really was to talk about innovation, not only here at the DCRI, but broadly across campus. And so Suresh Malu might also join us in the third segment to talk about the Duke Institute for Health Innovation and what they're doing. But what we thought we'd do is try to weave this theme of innovation throughout the three talks, or maybe two for the Q&A, to get a little bit of a sense of what we're trying to do around spreading innovation in the first half, and then the second half of Eric talking about how we're taking that into execution and actually into the context of a broad study, not only in the DCRI, but outside. So we'll try to do that. There's the CME credit code. So first, I'm going to talk about the innovations group, and this is a group that we've had going for the last 3 to 4 years, and this is a theme a little bit different from Eric's talk, but I think we'll try to weave the two together. Emily, you're not the only one with an analogy around Halloween, so this is like the day after Halloween, you're trying to decide between, you know, the Crackle or the Mr. Goodbar, you're not sure what you need, but for this talk, you get it all today. We're going to try to cover a bunch of different things. We're going to start by talking about this innovations group, and I've been happy to work with Sarah Hollinger here about in this group recently, but this is really a group that's supposed to span the entire organization, and I'm happy to really talk about it here at New Conference, because we really want to think about how do we get faculty and staff involved in coming up with high-risk, high-reward ideas for the DCRI. These are all supposed to be mission-oriented around developing and sharing knowledge that's going to impact patient care. But that's about really fostering a culture of innovation, and I think that's inherent to anything that we do as a research organization, right? If you think about us, we are research and development in a lot of ways, but we always need to think about how we might be able to do things differently. And Eric's talk really going to tee that up in terms of how are we going to think about not only research differently, but how are we actually going to do care delivery differently as a result. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. And lastly, you know, I want to spend a little bit of time talking about something that's passionate for me in terms of how do we directly engage participants and patients in either research or the care delivery. And I think a lot of the focus that our innovation group has had in the first few years is really about how do we do that. And I'll go through a few examples of that. Here are some examples of topics and speakers that we've had earlier in the year. And I put this up just to highlight the different kinds of people who have spoken at the innovations group on a monthly basis, as well as the different kinds of topics that we've had. So for example, in the beginning of the year, we had Jeff Cole come to talk to us about population health analytics. This is an idea that he's been working on here at the DCRI, and then got funded successfully through the DHI Innovation Jam to really get funding around how we might develop analytics a platform for population health. And as you all know, Jeff has worked with Mark McClellan and others at the Marbella Center to really think about how do you take some of these things into practice. We talked about how we might work on using EHR data for clinical research itself. Amy Harris-Noda from DHTS came and talked with us about how do you build a case report form essentially within Epic itself. And I think this is an interesting way of directly taking data on that electronic health record to populate eventually a study database. This is, I think, a key topic for us as we start to think about Eric's talk. We had a medical student, Pierre Elias, talk to us about new innovations within Epic. One of the things that he specifically worked on was developing an automated way to calculate cardiovascular risk within Epic documentation. This is something that's in my notes now, an easy way for me on every patient without having to do anything to automatically populate the node with CV risk. And I think this is going to be important as we think about what Eric's going to present in the second half of my heart. So I'd like to come back to this topic specifically. We've also had local and distant startup companies come and talk to us about things that they are doing in other spaces, and I think this is interesting for us. I did put up here that one of the companies that we had come at the latter part of last year was Automated Insights. Does anybody know who Automated Insights is?
They're looking at football.
right side of your football, and you get a scholarship board of how you did the previous week, and you get a grade like D, like I do, then that's probably coming from a group that's actually here at the Durham Bulls in right field, and it's called Automated Insights, and they do natural language generation and prose around all the data that's collected about you and when you're playing fantasy football. So throughout the week, you have a certain score that you generate by the players you play, and at the very end, they come up with a nice report card that's in prose form about how you did. We had this company come and talk to us about how we might use this during the conduct of the clinical trial. So if you think about how we might be able to do risk-based monitoring or help sites understand how they're actually rolling in the trial, we can maybe automate a lot of what we have from a data standpoint into prose that can help the site truly understand how they're doing a clinical trial and engage better with us so that we enroll patients better. We had Janet Becker from our own faculty talk about the sixth final. I'll spend a little bit more time on this. This is the first research kit study developed by the DGRI that is now live in the App Store and available to patients all over to help participate in a study about gait speed. And then we had Michael Pensier, for example, talk about the Center for Predictive Medicine and what he's doing around predictive modeling, particularly with the healthcare system. I think, again, this is an example of what Eric has been talking about. As a research organization, how much value can we have to the caregiver settings across the street? And so a lot of the work that they've done around predictive modeling for sepsis and other conditions, I think we have to start here and disseminate. And lastly, Ken Manson, who's here as well, has talked a lot about digital health. And I'd love to, if it's okay, to credit him in terms of some of the slides I'll show later, because I think this is part of the opportunity I think we have moving forward. Not only using things like research kit to do studies directly with patients, but really thinking about how do we take both PROs and quantitative data collected by patients and directly use that towards study endpoints. We really want to think about how do we move this from not only a forum where we discuss some of these topics into a body that's going to identify not only the opportunities to start to facilitate that into progress. And I think, you know, one of the things that we've done with this meeting so far is really get the right people around the table to think about this. But as you all probably know, Eric Peterson and the executive team are very invested in terms of how does DGRI really view innovation moving forward. And I think there's going to be funds available for all of us to really think about how do we do research differently in the future. We want this forum to be a forum for you all to present some of those ideas. So hopefully we can match that up with some of the funds that are now available for investment in innovation. So if you have ideas, this is my shameless plug, Sarah's shameless plug for the forum to be used by you to present some of the ideas. Feel free to email me. If you'd like, we have several means available where we'd like to have you present ideas where you think you might be able to help the DGRI do things differently towards its own mission. Here's an example, I think, of how we try to do this creatively. If you've seen Shark Tank,